Tanto Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Woman in the Water by Charles Finch, narrated by James Langton. Chapter 1. For a little more than an hour, on that May morning in 1850, the only sound in the flat in St. James's Square was the rustling of newspapers, punctuated occasionally by the crisp shear of a pair of sharpened scissors through newsprint. There were two men at the highly polished breakfast table by the window, three stories above street level. One was in an impeccable grey suit, the other in a ratty brown smoking jacket. Both were too intent upon their work to glance out from this high vantage at their panoramic view of the soft spring day, the shy sunlight, the irregular outlines of the two nearby parks, lying serene within the smoke and stone of the city. The new leaves upon the trees, making their innocent green way into life, on branches still so skinny that they quivered like the legs of a foal. Finally, Charles Lenox, the one in the smoking jacket, threw down the last of his newspapers. "Ha! Done!" he said. "You're as slow as a milk train, Graham." There was a teapot on the table, and Lenox poured himself another cup from it, adding a spoonful of sugar from a small silver bowl. He took a satisfied bite from a piece of cinnamon toast, whose existence he had previously forgotten, and which had been prepared by the discreetly well-dressed man sitting opposite him, his valet. "It's not speed, but quality of attention that matters, sir," Graham said. He didn't look up from his own newspaper, the second to last of a towering pile.
"What a lot of nonsense," replied Lenox, rising and stretching his arms out. "Anyway, I'll get dressed while you finish. How many have you got so far?"
"Nine, sir."
"10 for me."
Graham's pile of clipped articles was much tidier than Lennox's, but he did look up now, as if tempted to say something less than entirely respectful, and then gave his familiar slight smile, shook his head, and resumed his study. He was a compact, sandy-haired person, with a face that was gentle and temperate, but looked as if it could keep a secret. There were few people Lenox cared for, or trusted more. When the young master of the house emerged again, he was changed out of his shabby jacket and into a handsome suit of his own, a heather grey, two shades lighter than Graham's, and perhaps 30 times as expensive. Such was life in England. Lenox had been born to a family of aristocrats, Graham to a family of tenant farmers. Yet they were true friends. Graham had been Lennox's scout throughout his 3 years at Balliol College, Oxford, and following Lennox's graduation 7 months before, had moved to London with him as his manservant. 7 months for Lennox of exhilaration, missteps, uncertainty, and novelty. Why? Because, as his peers from Oxford were settling into the usual pursuits, Lennox was trying, against the better advice of nearly every soul he encountered, and so far, with absolutely no success at all, to become something that did not exist, a private detective. He was also, most unhappily, in love. Graham was done now.
"How many did you finish with?"
Lennox asked this question as he peered into an oval mirror and straightened his tie. He had a bright face, with a very short, clipped beard and light brown hair and eyes. He still did not quite believe himself to be an adult, but evidently he was, for he was the possessor of these airy and spacious rooms in the heart of Mayfair. This one, large and central, had the atmosphere of a gentleman's club. There were books scattered about it, comfortable armchairs, and handsome oil paintings on the wall, though the brightness of the sunlight in the windows made it feel less confined than most gentlemen's clubs. It also contained, to his knowledge, no slumbering gentlemen, whereas gentlemen's clubs generally did, in Lennox's experience. There were tokens here and there of his two great interests, besides detection, that was. These were travel and the world of ancient Rome. There was a small but authentic bust of Marcus Aurelius, tilted windowward on one bookshelf, and everywhere were numerous stacks of maps, many of them much marked and overcrossed with pencilled itineraries, fantasies of adventure. Russia
was his current preoccupation. It was this room in which he spent all but his sleeping hours.
10 articles, sir,
said Graham, who also spent a great deal of time here.
Evens, then. Shall we go over them this afternoon?
By all means, sir.
Normally they would have compared their findings immediately. Graham, sharper than all but a few of the fellow students that Lenox had known at England's greatest university, had become his most valuable sounding board as he embarked on his new career. Every morning they each read the same set of papers and cut out the articles they thought were of any relevance, however oblique, to the matter of crime in London. They rarely matched more than 7 or 8 of their selections. 10 was about an average total. Half the fun was in seeing where they hadn't overlapped. The other half was in the immense chronology of crime-related articles that Lenox, who was by nature a perfectionist, a completist, had managed so far to accumulate. This morning he had an engagement, however, so they would have to wait to add to their archive. Lenox donned a light overcoat. Graham saw him to the door.
A very happy birthday, Mr. Lenox, sir.
Ah, Lenox grinned. I reckoned you'd forgot. Thank you, Graham. Thank you very much. Are my gloves at hand?
In the pocket of your coat, sir.
Lenox patted his pockets and felt them.
So they are.
Then he smiled.
At hand? Did you catch that?
Very good, sir.
It was a pun. Gloves, hands.
Graham nodded seriously.
One of these retroactive puns you hear so much about, sir, conceived only during its accidental commission.
On the contrary, very carefully plotted and then executed flawlessly, which is what really counts.
He checked his tie in the mirror once more and then left, bounding downstairs with the energy of a man who had youth, money, and the prospect before him that day of breakfast with an amiable party. On the sidewalk, however, he hesitated. Something had stuck in his mind. Worth bothering about? Reluctantly, he decided that it was, yes. He took the stairs back up 2 at a time. Graham was tidying away their breakfast, and looked up expectantly when Lenox entered.
Sir?
The one about the month anniversary, Lenox said. You saw that?
Of course, sir.
Lenox nodded.
I assumed, but it was in that dish-rag, the Challenger.
This was one of the least reputable newspapers in England.
Still, if today's May 2nd, pull out the clipping from April 8th to the 13th, say, would you? Perhaps even the 7th and the 14th, to be careful.
By all means, sir.
Lenox felt better for having come back upstairs. The letter had bothered him. He touched his hat.
Obliged, Graham. Good luck with Mrs. Huggins. Just steer clear of her, I say.
Graham frowned. Mrs. Huggins was Lennox's housekeeper. Lennox neither wished to have nor enjoyed having a housekeeper, but his mother had insisted immovably upon her employment when he moved to London, and both Lennox and Graham were in the midst of dealing with the consequences of that rigidity.
Well,
now I know, close quarters. Anyhow, I shall be back before long. Keep heart till then.
This time Lenox went downstairs and strode into the streets without turning back. From St. James's Square he walked up Pall Mall, with its imposing row of private clubs. There was a scent of tobacco on the breeze. The sky was smoothing from white into a pure blue, no clouds. He had been 23 for 9 hours. Rum, he thought. It felt a very advanced age. Yesterday, or thereabouts, he had been 14. Then, in a flash, 19. Tomorrow, no doubt, he would be white-haired, his grandchildren or the younger members of a gentleman's club ignoring him as he sat in his comfortable spot by the fire. Ah, well, such was life. The clip they had both taken from the Challenger that morning, May 2nd, remained on his mind as he walked. He had always had a very good recall, and the piece had been short. He was therefore able to run over it exactly in his mind, probing for points of softness, susceptibility. Sirs, it has been roughly a week, shy of 1 month, since I committed the perfect crime. Perhaps in doing so I should have foreseen how little remark the press would make upon it, and how little progress the police make in solving it. Nevertheless, it has been an anticlimax, especially as murder is a crime generally taken quite seriously, too seriously if we are honest with ourselves about the numerousness and average intellectual capacity of our population in our society, to witness how little comment my own small effort has aroused. I therefore give you advance warning that I shall commit another perfect crime to mark this anniversary. A second woman. It seems only just to my mind. Perhaps this declaration will excite the generally sluggish energies of England's press and police into action, though I place no great faith in the notion. With regards, a correspondent. Far and away the likeliest thing was that this letter was a fraud, an editor at the Challenger who needed to fill 3 inches of column. The second likeliest was that it was a hoax. The third likeliest was that it was a harmless delusion. Far down the list, 4 or 5 spots, was the chance that someone had in fact committed a perfect crime, a little less than a month earlier, and written to boast of it. 4 or 5 spots, though, not so far down the list, really, as to make it impossible. Lenox cast his mind back to the period 3 weeks or so before, which was populated with several crimes of interest. Most of them solved, however, none of them perfect either, that he could recall. But Graham would pull the clippings. And hadn't there been... But now Lenox found that he was turning up Singletary Street, which put him in sight of rules. Soon he would be sitting next to Elizabeth. His heart began to beat a little more quickly, and as he opened the door of the restaurant where his elder brother had arranged a birthday breakfast for him, the letter slipped out of his mind. Chapter 2. Charles's brother Edmund, who would one, hopefully distant, day be Sir Edmund Lennox, 11th Baronet of Market House, was his only sibling. They greeted each other with an affectionate handshake at the door of a comfortable panelled room. Beside Edmund was his young wife Molly, Emily in more formal settings, who was pretty and countryish, not most at home in London.
"Happiest of birthdays, my dear fellow," Edmund said.
"Well, thank you.
I remember when I was 23.
"I would be worried if you couldn't remember 3 years ago."
"Halcyon days," said Edmund, with mock rue.
Molly kissed him, laughing. "Happy birthday, Charles." He kissed her back. "Thank you, my dear sister." The two brothers looked similar, but Edmund was fuller in the shoulders than Charles, who was more naturally willowy, of good height, but also reckoned taller than he was because of his slenderness. They had grown up in the Sussex countryside, and those were, in truth, halcyon days, each of them a horse for his 10th birthday, swimming in the pond next to Lennox House during summers, long-standing family traditions at Christmas, 2 happy parents, on to Harrow, one of the nation's pair of great public schools, at 13, and then, like toppling dominoes, to the University of Oxford. Lennox was at an age when his childhood felt at once very near and very far. So much had intervened between the 10th birthday and this 23rd one, as if the former had happened either that morning or 100 years ago. His horse at Lennox House, Cinder, was 14 now. Imagine that. In this room, coming across to greet him, one by one, with hearty handshakes as they noticed him, were representatives from the various phases of his life. Their amiable, fat-jowled, older cousin Homer Lennox was sipping a glass of warm negus by the fire, speaking to their Aunt Martha, whom they had both loathed as children, and now both rather liked. Lennox's particular friend from Harrow, Hugh Smith, strode over. There were Oxford friends, too, a part of Lennox's little set in London here. A happy small gathering, whose constituents, one would have said, bespoke a celebrant of exceptional good fortune. And the Lord knew it was true his life had been fluid, untroubled by larger worries, essentially without difficulties. He was deeply conscious of it. Except that now
he had made this queer decision to become a consulting detective. Lennox knew, though he was determined to ignore the fact, that during these first 7 months in London, he had become a joke. To think of it too much would have pained him, however. And among these 12 or so people, at any rate, he was yet loved. Soon they were all seated, and he found himself next to Elizabeth. They had said a brief hello earlier, but now she turned to him with a face ready to be pleased, fingers running idly along a silver necklace she often wore.
"Well, tell me, Charles," she said, "are you going to see Obeish?"
He gave her a look of consternation.
"Not you too."
She looked at him with reproach.
"Don't be a curmudgeon."
"I?"
"Yes, you."
He smiled. She was a pale-cheeked young woman of 19, in a blue dress, with lively dark eyes and white, even teeth. They were very close friends, perhaps even what you would call best friends. She had been married for just more than 3 months now, in love, days into her first London season.
"I take it you've been, then?" he asked.
"Of course. He was quite a sight, the dear, still just a baby."
Unconsciously she touched the spot where a grey ribbon encircled her dress. She must, Lennox thought, his reflex for observation never switched wholly off, have thought every day since her marriage of the quickening that would mean she was with child.
"From what I hear, he wallows a great deal."
"There are people of whom I could say the same,"
she said, looking at him dryly, and turned slightly away to take a spoonful of soup. Lennox laughed. He picked up his own spoon.
"I am never entirely certain how personal your comments are."
"Good," she said.
Their conversation was the same one happening all over the city, because at the London Zoo just then was the greatest commotion the metropolis had witnessed in many years, perhaps even since the Queen had introduced the city to Prince Albert. This Obeish was what these natural philosophers had chosen to call, with straight faces apparently, a hippopotamus. The first in Europe since the time of the Romans, the first in England itself, well, ever, inasmuch as any learned person at the Royal Academy was able to discern. 10,000 people, an enormous number, perhaps 20 times the average, were visiting the zoo each day to lay eyes on the creature. He was a plump, potato-shaped fellow, at least according to the illustrations Lennox had seen in the papers and the descriptions that even very exalted members of the aristocracy, who wouldn't deign to look at certain foreign royals but had visited the hippopotamus with breathless excitement, had provided him.
"What tricks does he do?" Lennox asked Elizabeth.
"Tricks?"
"Yes, tricks."
She looked appalled.
"I don't know if you have fully grasped the dignity of this animal."
"Haven't I?"
She gave him a disappointed shake of her head.
"Tricks, indeed."
Great ceremony had preceded the hippopotamus, which had travelled up the Nile with an entire herd of cattle to provide it milk. A troop, led with pride by Sir Charles Augustus Murray, Her Majesty's consul to Egypt, who had enjoyed his triumph for less than a fortnight before finding his august reputation permanently sullied by the new nickname Hippopotamus Murray. No matter how admiringly he was addressed in this fashion, it seemed doubtful to Lennox that Murray could feel quite content with it after such a long and distinguished non-hippopotamus-based career. Now there were vendors selling little hippopotami figurines outside the zoo. The rulers on the continent were sick with envy. Children played nothing but hippo in the streets. The next step was to find Obeish a mate, and the energies of many stout Englishmen in Egypt were no doubt being squandered on that project as Charles and Elizabeth ate their soup. Even now Lennox always thought of his mother's nursery-era lesson in manners when there was soup at table. "Like ships upon the sea, I push my spoon away from me."
"Anyhow," Elizabeth went on, "when I'm in the country there will be few enough spectacles. I ought to enjoy those in London while I can."
She was moving to her new husband's estate in the autumn, when his military regiment returned to England, to take up her rightful position as the wife of the heir to an earldom, second or third lady of the country.
That meant there were good works in her future, visits to the vicarage. Some glamour, too, to be sure, but as their friend Nellie had put it, country glamour. Because of her personal qualities, she deserved, in Lennox's estimation, both high position and high excitement. She would have only the former in her life beginning that autumn.
"You'll return often, I hope, however," said Lennox lightly, though his heart fluttered.
He had never proposed. He felt a familiar dull pain at his lack of courage. He had missed his chance. Sometimes, late in the small hours of the night, he wondered if he had missed his only chance.
"Your friends here will miss you."
She pushed back against the insinuation of his question slightly, at least in her posture, in her voice, a certain formality entering them, though never anything like unfriendliness.
"Oh yes, I imagine, when James finds it necessary."
She leaned forward slightly to address the young gentleman on Lennox's left, a third.
"Hugh, have you seen the hippopotamus?"
Hugh gave them a scornful look.
"Have I seen the hippopotamus? Haven't I seen the fellow 6 times?
6?
I consider him more of a brother than a friend."
"Disgraceful," said Lennox.
"You're outnumbered," said Elizabeth.
"This is a table that looks favourably upon Obaish. Hugh and I won't hear a word against him."
Across from them, deep in conversation with Eleanor Arden, another of their set, was Lennox's aunt. He appealed to her as a last resort.
"Aunt Martha," he said,
and the table fell silent as she looked up.
"Tell me that you at least haven't condescended to visit the London Zoo in the past 2 weeks. The old ways must still mean something."
She hesitated, a grey-haired and portly older woman, resplendent in a spangled dress of gold and red, and then said,
"I must admit that I paused there yesterday."
Everyone at the table burst into kind laughter. She gave the room a generalized look of indignation.
"One likes to keep abreast, you know, even at my age."
When the soup had been cleared, and there was a lull in the conversation, even the hippopotamus parts of it, Edmund stood up. He lifted his glass.
"What about a toast?" he said.
"Yes, yes," said one or two people, and lifted their glasses too.
"Charles moved to London in the fall, as you all know," said Edmund. "So far, he has not been imprisoned, lost money in a 3-shell game on the Strand, or eloped to the Continent with a dancer."
There was more laughter, and Lennox called out,
"Give me 6 weeks.
"He has also," Edmund said with stout, awkwardly footed pride, "begun his very significant work as a detective. Very significant work, very." "Ha ha," said Hugh. "I am proud of him for it, and I think we ought to have a double toast to him for it. Join me, please. 2 cheers for Charles."
As they cheered, Lennox felt himself blush, a little hollowness of embarrassment in his throat and chest. He would have preferred no reference to his work, but he accepted the toast, said thank you, all here loved him, the moment passed, and soon the conversation again became general. It was beneath the station of all those present here to have a profession, unless it be politics, arms, or God. It had been many generations since the family of any of them had done work with their hands, season upon season, year upon year, century upon century. A gentleman scientist, fine, or, in an eccentric case, an explorer, a collector, an equerry, a horse breeder. But even the most eccentric of these would never have dreamed of taking work as a detective. England's caste system was too inflexible to allow for it. It was this fact that had poisoned Lennox's 7 months here, only unto illness, not death, and mostly for his poor parents. But still, still. Making it worse was how desperately little headway he had made. He was laughed off in Scotland Yard, he had tried repeatedly to make allies there, and laughed off in a different kind of way at the parties, where he was still welcome, but more often than before because of his brother, or because of Elizabeth, Eleanor, Hugh, his friends. In the fullness of these 7 months, he had had 2 cases, precisely, and this despite charging no fee. He had solved both, one a pitiably simple matter of a missing fiancé. He had an extant family in Bournemouth. Unfortunately for the young woman who had entreated Lenox to find him so that she could marry him, and one an embezzler at a mid-sized firm in the city. Both cases had been referred to him by friends. Neither had led to more work. At the end of the breakfast, some 2 hours later, a great deal of it spent reminiscing over old village cricket matches with his cousin Homer, he found himself momentarily in a quiet corner of the room with Elizabeth, who was donning her overcoat. She was due at a luncheon, straight from one meal to another, she said, and sheepishly added that when she was fat she would have to feign an illness to avoid going out, and Lenox, putting his own cloak on, took the opportunity to ask how she had been, which parties she would be going to. But suddenly, realizing that they were by the grace of chance briefly isolated from everyone else, he said anxiously, "Listen here, do you think I'm a fool about the detective business? Answer me honestly, Elizabeth. Be brutal. Nobody else will. Nobody whose opinion I care for." She gave the question a look of real surprise, and then shook her head, concern in her eyes.
"Never, never, never," she said. She touched his cheek. "I think you are valiant as a lion, Charles, and wondrous affable."
Before he had a chance to reply, she had turned away to say her other goodbyes. For his part, he did not move for at least 10-15 seconds. He could still feel her hand on his cheek. Chapter 3. Lenox walked home. His path took him through Green Park, the quiet warmth of the sunlight falling through its trees. When he arrived, Graham met him at the door. Uncanny how he did that, and opened it, taking Lennox's gloves, hat, and jacket.
"A pleasant morning, I trust, sir?" he asked.
"Very pleasant, thank you," said Lennox. "Did you pull the newspaper clippings from April by any chance?"
"I did, sir. They're in the sitting room, along with the papers we clipped this morning. I have cleared away everything else except the Times."
"Thank you."
"You also have a wire from Lennox House, sir."
"A wire?"
Lennox frowned.
"Let me see it, please. And bring me a cup of black coffee, if you would."
He needed his mind sharp, and he had consented to a festive glass of hot brandy and spice at the end of breakfast.
"Right away, sir," said Graham.
Loosening his tie a quarter inch, Lennox went and sat down at the round table by the window. He noticed from this higher vantage that the skies toward the east had darkened a little. It might well rain before long. There were two neat stacks of paper at his chair. At the top of one was the telegram from home, with that morning's clippings beneath it, and at bottom, the Times. Then, next door, the thick stack of irregularly shaped April clippings pulled from the filing cabinet, dating from the window of time when this perfect criminal claimed to have committed his perfect murder. The first thing Lennox did was open the wire. Letters from Sussex took only around 36 hours to arrive, so a telegram was relatively rare. This one brought welcome news rather than bad, thankfully. "Bound for London tomorrow, stop. Wallace, stop. Savoy as quick visit, stop. Arriving by 2:22, stop. Dinner Edmonds, stop. Will be by yours before to pick you up. If you cannot come to me sooner, stop. All love, stop. Mother, stop. Oh, and happy birthday, my dear, 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 stop. Mother." This telegram would have been impenetrable to most, but it was clear as a June sky to Lennox. What it indicated was that his mother was coming here to see the family's solicitor, Wallace. The family's townhouse, which they kept open from September to April, wasn't worth reopening for just a night or two, so she had taken a room at the Savoy. She would like to see Charles straight away, but understood that he might be occupied. The latest she would see him was in the hour before their family dinner at his brother's house, but perhaps he would come to the Savoy earlier, if it was convenient. He was pleased at the news. He had plans to visit Lennox House in a few weeks, for the first weekend of summer. But he and his mother were, as both his brother and father had observed, like a pair of old shoes. He composed a quick reply, saying that he would meet her at Charing Cross. Then he tore the wire in two and dropped it into the waste paper basket. That done, he turned his attention to the articles he and Graham had clipped from the morning's papers. 9 of their 10 selections had overlapped, a high number. Graham had noticed something he hadn't, however, a small article, 4 paragraphs, about a sailor who had failed to report for duty in Plymouth, a notable occurrence only because he was a generally very reliable hand, a boatswain with 9 years aboard the Colourway, who had never before failed to report. Lenox wondered why he had missed it, then realized, looking at Graham's careful notation, that it was because it had been on a page with a larger story about a crime in the West End. He twisted his lip in disappointment at himself. On the other hand, it meant that he had spotted one article that Graham hadn't. He looked to see which. Ah, the dog thefts in Parkham Court. No, Graham wouldn't have considered that notable. Dog theft was very common, but Lenox liked anything strange, anything aslant of common experience. In this case, slight differences. These dogs were all domestic, some of them quite doted upon. That was rather out of the ordinary run of things. The clipping would go in today's file, and he would remember it as he tried to weave in his mind, thread by slender thread, a tapestry that contained a full picture of this great city's crime. Each article they cut out was another thread, its own unique shade. The names of streets, as they recurred, which neighbourhoods saw which types of crimes, the first and second and third most common ways thieves were caught. He wanted to know all of it. He was young and ambitious, and very certainly determined to know all of it. Graham returned with a cup of coffee on a silver tray. Lenox thanked him and, taking a sip, leaned back in his chair. The rain had just started, light and steady. He gazed through the window for a moment. Then he looked up.
"Well, Graham," he said, "what about this perfect crime, the letter from the Challenger?"
"I was not able to make a connection based upon the articles from April, sir. Perhaps you will perceive something that I have not, however."
Graham reached down and arranged the array of clippings that was on the table from 1 month previous, 17 in all.
"The single prominent murder was the singly one, sir."
"That," Lenox said distractedly.
The singly case had been solved immediately. 6 witnesses, who had seen a baker in Bromley beat his next-door neighbour on the street over a matter of honour. The neighbour had lingered 30 hours on this side of the Vale before succumbing. The papers never used any other word to his injuries. Lenox skimmed the remaining clippings. None of them recorded anything close to as memorable as an unsolved murder.
"Very little in that period, sir, as you can see," said Graham.
Lenox leaned back, thinking.
"Perhaps it really was a perfect murder, sir, entirely unremarked, thought to be a natural death, even."
"Interesting," Lenox sighed. "Or else, of course, it's the editor of this reckless newspaper stirring the pot, hoping to give everyone a fright."
"A likelier possibility, no doubt, sir."
Lenox was unsure. There had been something just authentic about the letter, something sinister. On the other hand, he might have been willing that into existence, since he was desperate for work to do.
"Ah, well."
Then he remembered something, though.
What was it?
He narrowed his eyes, thinking. It was the singly manslaughter that had called it to mind. There had been something else around that time, something. He jumped out of his chair, pushing it back.
"Graham!"
"Sir," said Graham.
But Lenox, wasting no time on a reply, hurried across the room to the filing cabinet.
"The letter was printed today, May 2nd, he said, rifling through papers quickly. "But that doesn't mean it was sent yesterday. We have no idea when it was sent. There was no date on it."
"Sir?"
"We may have pulled the articles from the wrong time, since we assumed it was sent yesterday, surely because it was printed today. Yes, look."
Graham leaned over Lennox's shoulder.
"What is it, sir?"
Lennox held up a clipping, waving it in his gripped hand.
"March the 29th. Here it is. We both clipped it, of course, given the circumstances. Walnut Island."
Graham's eyebrows rose.
Walnut Island.
Lennox nodded grimly.
If the letter is referring to this, it means we are already 3 days past the date the letter was sent, perhaps longer.
The meaning of this dawned on Graham.
Oh, no.
Yes, if any of this is real, a second murder may be committed at any moment. Come, get your jacket, Graham, and I'll pull all the files on Walnut Island. We must fly.
Chapter 4. The offices of the Rag, known as the Challenger, lay toward the cheap end of Fleet Street. Every English newspaper was quartered along this avenue, high and low. This was low. The better class of newspaper inhabited the other end of the Fleet, which was so ancient that it had been a principal route through Roman London. Graham and Lennox alighted from a hansom cab at Ludgate Circus at a little after 3 o'clock. The Challenger was housed in a two-story building that tilted slightly left and no doubt gave a tremendous amount of business to the adjacent Ludgate Arms, a pub with a low, skulking, treacherous look to it. Despite stiff competition, journalism was probably the best lubricated profession in the city. "New-made pies," the pub advertised in its window.
"Interesting choice, a half-block from the home of Sweeney Todd," Lennox said, pointing toward the words.
This character, the villain of a penny dreadful called The String of Pearls, was most vivid in Londoners' minds at the moment, despite being fictional. More than three-quarters of people in a recent newspaper poll had believed him to be real.
"Intentional, perhaps," said Graham quietly in reply.
"Good point."
Lennox knocked at the door, Graham a step behind and a step to the side of him. A porter answered,
"Yes."
Lennox held out a half-shilling.
"Here to see the editor."
The coin vanished so quickly that it might have been a street trick. The door opened a tick wider.
"Up right, up left."
They followed these directions and were soon entering a large room filled with a surprisingly healthy glow of sunlight. The Challenger was a paper for the masses, but evidently the pennies of the masses added up. The building wasn't much to look at, but here inside all the desks were handsome, and the men seated at them wore natty suits as they churned out their copy, shouting to each other across the room, paper littered everywhere.
"Is the editor here?"
Lennox asked of a random fellow with greasy dark hair tucked behind his ears. He pointed at a door.
"But you won't sell him anything, Gov. He's bought it all and sold it for twice what he paid already."
"Thanks, I'm buying, not selling," said Lennox.
"What's your pockets, then?"
The door of this lone private office was ajar. Outside sat a woman. Lennox smiled at her and handed over his card. It said Charles Lennox on one line, then an address on the next. He hadn't been able to bring himself to add the words private investigator between the two. It was very plainly an expensive object, the address equally plainly an expensive one, and she sat up straighter.
"I would very much value 3 or 4 minutes of Mr. Kennington's time," Lennox said. "Mr., are you an acquaintance of Mr. Kennington?"
Lennox, his eyes always moving, had noticed the name on the masthead of an open copy of the Challenger they had passed.
"He'll want to see us."
She hesitated, but a Briton could nearly always be counted upon to pay obeisance to class, and she said, rising,
"Follow me."
A bulldog-looking person behind an absolutely enormous desk, a desk the size of many maids' bedrooms in London, glanced up as they entered.
"Who's this?"
"This is Mr. Charles Lennox," the woman said. "And, sir?"
"Oh, only his valet, madam," Graham said, with a hard T.
"Valet?" repeated Kennington.
He accepted the card from his secretary. Between the valet and the card, he was as impressed as the secretary, ready to give them a moment.
"I see. What is it that brings you across town, Mr. Lennox?"
"From more salubrious precincts," was implied. Lennox handed over the clipping of the letter about the perfect crime.
"We're here about this letter."
Kennington looked at it briefly and handed it back.
"Well,
is it real?"
Kennington got a cautious look on his face.
"It is, as it happens."
"Might we ask how it came into your possession?"
He glanced at his pocket watch.
"Miss Adams, fetch the cart of incoming letters."
The secretary left.
"Does that mean you still have it?" Lenox asked.
"Should do."
There was a silence.
"It's a handsome office," said Lenox.
"What's your concern with the letter?"
"Ah."
He had been ready for that question. "There is a family whose son has disappeared, no doubt gambling in Monaco, but we have promised to follow every lead." Kennington frowned. The valet and that explanation didn't add up.
"You're doing this for the money?"
Lenox shook his head.
"No, not at all. Just curiosity. I've always been interested in crime. Take them as they come. I assisted late last year on the Marbury case."
This was a curious matter of some 6 months before, tangentially involving a friend, which Lenox had helped solve by slipping information anonymously to the Yard. Now he wished he had done it in person. It was the case he thought of as his first, even though he hadn't been the primary detective. It was after Marbury that he had decided once and for all to follow his instinct and pursue this line of work. After Marbury that he and Graham had begun clipping the newspapers. The editor's curiosity was evidently satisfied by this explanation.
"I was in gutta percha for a while, myself, then rubber. Bought this thing last year. Circulation has doubled. We'll be moving up the street in the next year or so."
Lenox raised his eyebrows.
"Congratulations."
"Bloody stories and tear-jerkers, that's what people want, you know."
"I don't think there's any question about that."
"Easier than gutter percha. Ships sink." He paused. "You're very young."
"I thank you."
Kennington laughed and pointed at Graham, though he had barely appeared to notice him.
"Anyhow, you'd have to walk a while to find the man who's going to fool this valet of yours. I'll just tell you that for free, since you aristocrats never know anything yourselves. But I've looked into a few faces in my day."
Just then Miss Adams came into the room, pushing a file box on wheels. It appeared that the challenger kept thorough records. It wasn't what Lenox would have expected. Thorough, and thoroughly organised, too. Within just a moment, Kennington had found the letter. He held it out, and then, as Lenox reached to take it, pulled it back.
"A trade."
"A trade?"
"One story. A crime story. Put me onto it sometime. In the next month or two, say."
Lenox thought, and then nodded. "I accept your terms."
"Word is a gentleman."
Graham no doubt noticed the way that Lennox's posture stiffened slightly, the anger he felt at the question even being posed, but Kennington and Miss Adams would have missed it. Lenox nodded once more.
"Yes, you have my word as a gentleman."
Kennington nodded in turn at the deal he'd struck, then passed the letter to Lenox.
"It arrived 4 days ago, I believe."
4 days. That was a piece of absolutely crucial information, also a frightening one. Lenox did some quick calculations. He had reckoned that the 1 month anniversary referred to in the letter would be 4 or 5 days off, at the earliest May 7th, perhaps, today being the 2nd. But it might be much, much sooner. It might be this very day. The idea chilled his blood.
"You waited to publish it?" Lenox asked.
"Figured the fella for a crank. Still do. But we had a few spare column inches to fill, and it's excited a fair bit of reader interest. We'll probably run a follow-up head on it in the next day or two."
"How did the letter arrive?"
"Miss Adams," Kennington said.
Evidently the secretary was responsible for such matters.
"Unstamped under our door, sir, in the middle of the night. Must have been very late, as we don't generally print until 3. Between 4 and 6, nobody's in the building."
Lenox nodded.
"Thank you." "Not at all, sir. Is there a spare desk where we could look the letter over?"
Kennington said there was.
"Miss Adams will show you. Don't forget my crime story, Mr. Lenox. Goodbye, valet."
A moment later, Lenox and Graham were at an empty table in the newspaper's main room, both standing, leaning over, to stare at the thrice-folded letter and the small blue envelope it had arrived in. Miss Adams had left them to their own devices. The text was identical to that which the challenger had printed.
"Cheap paper," Lenox noted.
"Perhaps for anonymity," Graham suggested. Lenox shook his head.
"No, because it's a cheap pen, too."
"Can you tell, sir?" Graham asked.
Lennox pointed. "Look how often he has had to go back to his inkwell. The splotches come every other word, almost.
One of those metal nibs that are a dozen a penny. The ink's no good either.
I see.
Lenox frowned. Admirable penmanship, however.
Yes, indeed, sir.
And you see the other clue that goes along with admirable penmanship, of course?
Sir, said Graham.
Lenox, all of his 23, was not free of arrogance, the undergraduate vice.
Come, you can see here, Graham, where he has erased his pencil lines, faint but distinct, beneath each line of the letter.
Now Graham frowned.
I cannot see the significance of that, sir.
Oh. Oh. In what he hoped was a delicate way, Lenox said, we never had lines beneath our... We were smacked on the hand if we wrote crookedly at Harrow with the chalk. In its chalk holder, a great long wooden rod. I can still feel it.
Sir?
Lenox elaborated. Well, it's only at the free schools that one is taught to write line upon line.
Is it, sir?
I think because it is considered useful if your field is clerking. Lenox thought back to his lessons. A gentleman's writing mustn't be too perfect, you see.
Ah, yes, sir, said Graham. I see.
His face remained impassive. He was a fellow, Lennox valet, or butler, perhaps, if you wish to use the slightly grander word, who learned from every direction, indiscriminately, his mind as sharp as the head of a newly fledged arrow. He would absorb this piece of information as he had every other one, that asparagus was eaten with the fingers, for instance, that one said sofa, not settee, and store it away forever. Lenox felt a twinge of guilt. He smoothed the paper under his hand.
I think we have a picture of our man, at least, he said.
Sir,
said Graham. Come, we'll discuss it in the hansom. We must go to Scotland Yard as quickly as possible. If the writer of the letter keeps his promise, they'll have only a day to prevent a murder. Not 5 or 6, as I thought. It may even be a matter of hours.
Yes, sir.
Lennox shook his head grimly. It's bad, very bad, that we are the first to follow up. If the Yard cannot solve the matter, we may only hope that the next murder is not so brutal or random as the one at Walnut Island.
Chapter 5 Walnut Island, that was the case described in the clippings that Lennox had pulled from their oak filing cabinet in St. James's Square before they left for the Challenger. The 6 articles were spread from across 3 days, 3 on the 1st, April 5th, 2 on the 2nd, and 1 on the 3rd, only the Telegraph pursuing the story into the morning hours of April 7th. It had perhaps passed through the newspapers so quickly because, despite having several sensational elements, it had produced no clues, no leads, no identifications, nothing to add to the splashy first accounts. Did that make it a perfect crime? The most reliable of the 3 newspapers that had reported on the matter was the Times. Their piece had appeared on the first page of the densely typeset newspaper, datelined to London. Thames Mystery. Inspectors Sinex and Exeter charged with investigation. Identification considered difficult. Public assistance sought. The body of a woman was found early Thursday morning by Jacob A. Shoemaker, charman of Randall House, a residence situated upon the small islet near Twickenham, known locally as Walnut Island. Shoemaker reported to police that he had discovered a sailor's trunk among the rushes near the island's east end, heavily sodden, apparently fetched there by the tide. The trunk was clasped, but not locked. Inside was the body of a woman, estimated in age as being between 20 and 40. The trunk had no identifying marks, and the body was unclothed. The cause of death was strangulation. The deceased had long black hair, a prominent brow, and well-kept teeth, according to Inspector Sinex of Scotland Yard. These and other details match no known missing person for whom the London police are actively searching, Sinex confirmed to the Times. He added that the Yard is pursuing several promising leads. Inspectors Sinex and Exeter will jointly handle the matter going forward. Descriptions matching those of the deceased may be forwarded either to the Times or to Scotland Yard. No statement was released by Sir Winston Kellogg, owner of Randall House,
previously home to the Randall family. Sir Winston and his family are presently in Scotland. No reward has thus far been offered.
"Several promising leads," Lennox quoted angrily as he and Graham read over the article together again, heads huddled, on the way to the yard.
It was a fairly common kind of article. London had birthed babies and buried bodies beyond counting since its foundation. Once every 2 or 3 days, it produced an unidentified corpse. Some of these corpses caught the public imagination, but few of those that involved foul play were ever solved. On the other hand, this was the body of a young, or relatively young, woman, which was the sort the press liked to dramatize. The mention of her teeth was also a subtle indication that perhaps the police believed her to be well-born, not a prostitute, that is, the most usual victim of violent crimes, alas. There was also something macabre in her discovery on Walnut Island that might easily have stimulated the public imagination. It hadn't caught, however. It just hadn't. So it went. The other 5 articles offered variants of the same information, none so thorough as the Times. The final one, in the Telegraph, volunteered only that Inspectors Sinex and Exeter had fielded several public visits. Before their visit to Mr. Kennington at the Challenger, Lennox and Graham had combed carefully through their files from the week preceding and following March 2nd. There were numerous crimes contained across these 150-odd articles, including a dozen murders, but most of them had been solved, and only one other, an odd stabbing in Romford, presented features of unusual interest. In their hansom cab, on the way to the yard, Lennox said thoughtfully,
"April 5th. A sailor's trunk is buoyant, so we may assume that it was floated down the Thames. In other words, would not need to have been dropped anywhere near the island. In fact, could have floated for days before it arrived at Walnut Island."
"Indeed, sir."
"On the other hand, such a trunk floating down river wouldn't be likely to survive the small fry for longer than a quarter of an hour."
There were hundreds of skiffs and other flat-bottomed boats, perhaps thousands, that floated daily upon the Thames, serving every purpose imaginable. Some ferried sailors between the huge corvettes and brigs anchored near the docks. Some sold meat pies, rum, blue pictures, newspapers. Anything of imaginable interest to these same sailors. Some were after river fish. Some were merely pickers, trawling the great waterway, scavenging what they could sell, down to paper at a halfpenny per £10.
Perhaps that indicates...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.